I'm Michelle Long. It's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 11 a.m. in Sydney. The headlines. Wall Street suffers its worst day in 2 years as high inflation hits the earnings of major retailers. Asian shares look set to mirror those losses. Here at home, the PSE Index stretched its winning streak to a third day, climbing back above the 6,700 level. Chris Mangan of ManganOnMarkets.com joins us for his market outlook. Philippine Central Bank Governor Benjamin Jokno hints at policy tightening ahead of the BSP's meeting this afternoon, saying the space for easy monetary policy has narrowed due to high inflation. And we take a look at the property market and how demand is picking up this year with Tomas Lorenzo of Torre Lorenzo Development Corporation later on the show. We begin with the financial markets, a bloodbath on Wall Street as shrinking profits of retailers renew fears inflation is hurting American companies. The Dow lost over 1,000 points while the S&P 500 plunged 4%. Both had their worst day since 2020. The tech-heavy Nasdaq, meanwhile, dropping 4.7%. Now, that decline came after Target's first quarter profit fell, and the company warned of a bigger margin hit on rising fuel and freight costs. The profit shortfall marked the first miss for Target since the third quarter of 2018. Target shares fell nearly 25% after its report, losing about $25 billion in market cap. Target's results follow rival Walmart, which trimmed its profit forecast for the year as rising costs of fuel and labor hurt its bottom line, while shoppers squeezed by decades-high inflation moved to buy cheaper products. Interest rate-sensitive growth stocks added to the plunge, with Amazon and Tesla falling nearly 7% each. Meanwhile, J.P. Morgan cut its expectation for U.S. economic growth for the second half of this year to 2.4% from 3%. It also trimmed its first half of 2023 target to 1.5% from 2.1%. J.P. Morgan added there may be enough of a growth slowdown to lead to a gradual increase in the unemployment rate later next year. Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, all the major indices pointing to a lower open when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. The overnight rout on Wall Street extending here in Asia amid mounting fears of a global economic downturn. The Nikkei 225, as you can see, sinking 2.4% after Japan's exports rose 12.5% in April, lower than expectations for a 13.8% increase. Japan's exports to China dropped nearly 6% due to renewed COVID lockdowns in Shanghai and Beijing. Meanwhile, South Korea's KOSPI index is down nearly 2%. While Australia's ASX 200 is down 1.8% in early trade. More news out of Asia. Sri Lanka is set to default on billions of overseas bonds as its new prime minister struggles to stabilize the economic crisis in the country, fueled by a lack of dollars and surging inflation. Its energy minister says they have also run out of money to pay for fuel. In corporate stories, Cisco Systems cutting its full-year earnings forecast after COVID lockdowns in China and the war in Ukraine dragged sales below estimates in the third quarter. The news said Cisco shares down 13% in extended trading. We're also looking at Tesla, which has been kicked out of the widely followed S&P 500 ESG index. S&P says this was due to its lack of low-carbon strategy and codes of business conduct, along with racism and poor working conditions reported at Tesla's California factory. Tesla CEO Elon Musk responded with harsh tweets, even calling ESG a scam. And Under Armour's Patrick Frisk is stepping down from his role as president and CEO effective June 1st. The move comes as the company struggles with supply chain disruptions and China lockdowns, which have pushed its shares down more than 50% this year. Back here at home, the Philippine Central Bank drops a hint on its monetary policy direction ahead of its rate-setting meeting this afternoon. The details from Warren De Guzman.
Philippine Central Bank Governor Ben Jokno has always been vocal on monetary policy, with the goal of making sure financial markets are never caught off guard when it comes to interest rates and policy adjustments. On Wednesday, a day before the third rate-setting meeting of 2022, Jokno dropped another big hint.
There is space for maintaining an accommodative policy stance has considerably narrowed, given how the April 2022 inflation of 4.9% settled near the higher end of the BSP's forecast range of 4.2 to 5%. Inflation pressures in recent months have been linked mainly to supply-side factors, which we argue are still best addressed by targeted non-monetary interventions by the national government. Meanwhile, second-round effects are starting to manifest. The recent approval of the wage hikes in the National Capital Region and Western Visayas leaves the door open for further increases in other regions, as wage petitions were deferred since 2020 as the pandemic disrupted economic activities. At the same time, the Philippine economy exceeded expectations after growing by 8.3% in the first quarter.
Sure enough, after the minimum wage hikes for the National Capital Region and Western Visayas, another round was announced for the Ilocos, Cagayan Valley, and Caraga regions. These second round effects could in turn stoke inflation further as they add to the cost of production. Jokno, however, also noted that there are some headwinds facing the economic recovery, which could give pause to plans for normalizing policy settings from the record low interest rates and historic accommodative measures put in place to boost the economy during the pandemic. Jokno says whatever the decision will be, it will be done in an orderly manner.
While spillovers from the Ukraine-Russia conflict will likely be limited, given our weak economic linkages with the two countries, slower growth in the global economy and higher commodity prices are headwinds to the Philippines' young economic recovery.
Currently, the central bank expects inflation to average 4.3% this year, above the preferred range of 2 to 4%, before easing to 3.6% in 2023. That outlook will be updated during Thursday's Monetary Board meeting. The Monetary Board's decision will be made known in a press conference at 3 p.m. Thursday afternoon. Warren De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
Our first guest this morning is a property developer that has enjoyed an annual revenue growth rate of 25% in the last 5 years and says they now see a 35% growth in the next five. Tore Lorenzo, CEO Tomas Lorenzo, thank you so much for joining us. Hi, good morning. Hi, Tomas. Your audio is, I think, turned off.
Good morning. Good morning, Michelle.
All right. We can hear you now. All right. So I want to start with this. You know, we know from mortgage data that there's so much pent-up demand from people just wanting to buy in. Just look at Pag-ibig Housing Loans hitting a record in the first quarter. What are you guys experiencing? I mean, where is demand coming from and how strong is it?
That's a very good question, Michelle. By the end of 2021, our revenues were near our pre-pandemic levels already. And there really is pent-up demand, especially with back to face-to-face classes and back to face-to-face work. So our university residences have really come back. And also even our young professional residences have also come back. So it's very strong. I think part of it is because, you know, there's this COVID fatigue. We had people who were living in their houses with their families for months or over a year. And many have chosen to move to a condo just to have a space for that they can call themselves. And because of our high-speed internet, people choose to stay in our condominiums. Because of that, there's also been a strong pent-up demand for leisure travel, which is our other business. Our hotels are doing very well. They've really come back strongly, especially in the Davao region. So I'm seeing really a lot of more than green shoots.
Tomas, and when you look at the supply, can your supply keep up with the demand though? I mean, how quickly do you think you'll be able to add to the pipeline? I know that you're currently in Quezon City, you're in Manila, Las Piñas, Batangas, and Davao. Do you have any plans to expand beyond these areas?
Well, that's another good question. During the pandemic, we did not stop our construction. We were fortunate enough that our projects were safely beyond the point where we'd have a material problem and a worker problem. So we were able to actually turn over three large high-rise buildings one in beside De La Salle College of St. Benilde, the other one block away from UP Manila PGH, and then even our Torre Lorenzo Loyola near Ateneo and the UP Diliman area did not stop. So we were lucky. And we have really a lot of follow-up projects near and around those areas. We've also looked really at outside of Metro Manila. I'm very bullish at the Davao market. We are, adding condominium towers to our Dusit Tani residence hotel at the back. We are adding more corporate centers and really moving forward with our business park in the Davao area. In the Lipa, Batangas area, we launched our second tower. We were very happy with our first tower. And we are also working on our Dusit Princess Hotel, also in the same complex.
Mm-hmm. And all of these properties, would you say, are mostly sold out and leased out already? What's the take-up like for these projects in your pipeline?
Yeah, the take-up has been very good. That's why we're able to launch our succeeding projects. Listening to your report earlier about, how the stock market is going, in real estate, we take a 5, 10, 15, 20-year view. And since I am also into university residences, regardless of how the economy does, the Filipino will always spend on education. So we see ourselves as part of the education budget of our buyers, and not really just as a investment budget as extra cash, because parents will always spend for their children to be in the safest and most comfortable area that they can live in near the schools.
Mm-hmm. Tomas, let's talk about pricing now. How quickly are prices going up for your properties in Metro Manila versus in other markets?
Surprisingly, people don't realize that it's more expensive to build outside of Metro Manila. They think that it's cheaper. It's not. Because of the quality that we put in, we have to actually import labor from outside to get that quality. There's been a shift. I've seen that some workers are going back to their provinces. So our pricing, we try to, make it affordable yet premium. So we try to be the best that developer in the area. We see ourselves as being unique. We always have a unique proposition, a premium proposition wherever we put up our projects. So pricing, because of, prices of goods, raw materials have gone up, but I think we'll be able to manage that mainly due to, our use of quick technology and mainly using, better techniques and really managing our costs, because we've been doing this for the last 25 years. So we've been through so many crises like this. We know how to manage our costs without sacrificing what is delivered.
Mm-hmm. And now that interest rates are rising, what's the prospect? How do you see that impacting your industry?
Well, that is an impact. It does impact a lot, interest rates. However, it's long term. People take 10-year, 15-year loan, and it's really the monthly amortization that is important. We have to make it affordable on a monthly basis, and not in total value, not necessarily in total value, because most of our buyers do take financing. And like I said, it is a, you know, university residence market. Mm-hmm. The Filipino will sacrifice everything just to be able to have a decent place for their child to live in. Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of sacrifice there.
Mm-hmm. Tomas, you earlier talked about your tourism play with the Dusit brand. In Davao, you've got a township business park as well. How do you see these properties contributing to the top line? I mean, currently, how much are they contributing versus what is the target?
Well, right now, those projects, well, the horizontal projects, of course, they do contribute directly. The hotel and leisure projects, they are starting to contribute. Luckily, we did surprisingly well in the pandemic because of people who were stuck in Mindanao and had nowhere to go. Mm-hmm. So even our resort projects did well because of people who were stranded. So all we became the wedding capital of Mindanao. And that does give us a big boost to our revenue stream. At the same time, it really helps develop all the properties around us, which we have acquired, which is in our land bank. So we can, you know, once you become a destination, we can push for more development in the area, which will also add to the revenue stream.
Mm-hmm. Sustainability, let's talk about that. I know that this is at the heart of Tole Lorenzo. What are some of the sustainability considerations of your projects?
Well, that's a good question. For sustainability, especially for, you know, our projects in Metro Manila, in NCR or any high-rise building, we really try to make sure that we use first local materials. We support local industry. So even that, we don't have to ship things from very, very far. So that's saving a lot of fuel and transport costs. Then we have a lot of ventilation that we put in, natural ventilation, natural lighting, which is very important. We have a lot of outdoor spaces, and all these outdoor spaces our residents really enjoy, especially in the pandemic. It's a place where they can breathe, of course, with social distancing. They can watch the Manila Bay sunset, you know, from the top of the buildings in our sky gardens. And a phenomenon which I've noticed is that many people have gotten pets over the pandemic. So we now are putting dog parks, well, actually paw parks, because some people have cats, in our buildings to really even let their precious dogs and cats have a place to spend their time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. All right. Before we get to the final question, what's growth looking like in the next 3 to 5 years for Tole Lorenzo? I mean, your land bank, how big is your land bank right now, and how big do you want it to grow in the next 3 to 5 years?
Well, just in the next 2 to 3 years, we have about 16 to 20 billion worth of projects coming up. And we should be able to develop that and, you know, move further. We've had spectacular growth pre-pandemic. I look at the pandemic as more of a pause than a full stop, because we continued, and then things are back to the growth phase. Like I said, Michelle, what we're trying to do is really to do what others have not seen yet or are not still aware of. So we see the trends that are moving in the market, and we try to integrate that so we can be the first to come up with it. Mm-hmm. Which is what we've been doing all these years.
Mm-hmm. And Tomas, final question, you said 16 to 20 billion pesos worth of projects in the next 2 to 3 years. Where are you going to get the money to bankroll those projects? Do you have plans to raise any more funds? I mean, rates are going up. Could raising through capital markets be an option? Take the company public, perhaps?
That is on the table. We have several options to really make sure that these projects are started and are finished. So yes, that is on the table, but we have to see, I guess, in the next few months, what the environment will be. I'm very bullish on the economy. We've been through so many ups and downs in the economy. And, you know, think of it this way. During the pandemic, land prices actually went up and not go down. They did not go down. So there are a lot of surprises in store for us on the positive side. So yes, we are looking at many options, and several options are on the table.
Very interesting what you said, Tomas. During the pandemic, land prices went up instead of go down. Why do you think so? What does that tell us?
It means there's a lot of, I guess there was excess cash, and people wanted to see and feel what they were investing in. So there was an increase in land prices, and any developer will tell you that land prices have really gone up, both in and out of Metro Manila, because people were just stuck at home, and some people were, you know, wanted to buy a second home. Some people wanted to buy an apartment to get away from their, you know, from being stuck at home. Some people wanted to buy a property in the province. So anywhere I go, this is personal experience, property prices have gone up significantly.
All right. On that note, on that optimistic note, Tomas, thank you so much for joining us. And we look forward to more positive news from your company. Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on to more news now, minimum wage earners in Metro Manila will see slightly higher paychecks starting next month. The Labor Department says the newly approved minimum wage hike for the capital region will take effect on June 4. The wage board last week granted a 33 peso increase, bumping up the regional rate for non-agricultural jobs to 570 pesos. The rate for those in the agri sector also increased to 533 pesos. As for Western Visayas, if the wage order for the region is released on Thursday, May 19th, then the order would take effect on June 5th. The Labor Department earlier granted a salary increase of 55 to 110 pesos for workers in the non-agriculture, industrial, and commercial establishments in the region. The move brought the daily minimum wage there to as high as 450 pesos. The scheduled hike in rates at the Manila Cavite Toll Expressway, or Cavitex, has been deferred by a week to May 22. Well, that hike was supposed to take effect last May 12. But the Cavitex Infrastructure Corporation says they decided to move it to a later date to give drivers and operators of public utility vehicles more time to register for the toll reprieve program. This would allow them to pay the price of the old toll rates of 25 pesos for Class 1 vehicles and 50 pesos for Class 2 vehicles. As for regular motorists, they would have to pay 33 pesos for Class 1, 67 pesos for Class 2, and 100 pesos for Class 3 starting Sunday. The toll operator says the new rates are inclusive of the 2011 and 2014 periodic toll petitions and add-on toll petition for enhancement works done on the expressway, which includes bridge lane widening works. Agriculture Secretary William Dar believes lowering rice prices to 20 pesos per kilo is possible in the next administration. Now, that was promised by leading presidential candidate Bongbong Marcos during his campaign. But Dar says it won't be easy to achieve, as it would require bumping the agriculture budget and providing more aid to rice farmers.
Really, to see na yung pagbaba ng cost of production, bigyan natin ng additional budget ang LFA to the level of 30 billion. So dagdagan natin ng 23 billion kada taon para makasustain sila ng buffer stock ng 30 days. Now, what are the effects of that? They will maintain yung farm gate price from present to, you know, present price, farm gate price kayo na 19 pesos, pwede naman itas yan sa 20.
Overseas, Russia's economic growth slows in the first quarter of the year as the initial impact of sanctions against President Vladimir Putin's invasion of Ukraine unfolds. The Russian economy expanded 3.5% in the first 3 months of this year after growing 5% in the previous quarter. It's also below the 3.7% growth forecast of economists. The first quarter is expected to be the last with sound growth as Russia takes a hit from sweeping sanctions for its February 24 invasion of Ukraine. Those sanctions, which hit major financial institutions and prompted an exodus of foreign companies, are expected to trigger a deep recession in Russia, with the economy contracting as much as 10% this year. U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen confirms she is pushing the Biden administration to eliminate some tariffs on Chinese imports. During a meeting with G7 finance ministers, Yellen said internal discussions are underway to reduce tariffs that are not very strategic and those hurting American consumers and businesses. Biden has said removing some tariffs on Chinese goods could be part of efforts to tame high inflation in the U.S. But reports say U.S. Trade Representative Catherine Tai prefers to keep them in place to develop a more strategic China trade agenda that protects U.S. jobs and keeps China's behavior in global markets in check. Former U.S. President Donald Trump imposed billions of dollars worth of tariffs on Chinese goods during a trade war with China back in 2018. Now, here are some economic events we're monitoring today, Thursday. As we reported, the Philippine Central Bank will announce its latest policy decision. Standard Chartered sees the BSP raising interest rates this afternoon, the first of many this year after the solid growth rates posted by the Philippines in the first quarter and as inflation remains elevated. The last one we got was at 4.9%. Hong Kong also coming out with its April jobs data. Hong Kong's unemployment rate rose to 5% in the January to March period. That is the highest since the third quarter of 2021, as COVID outbreaks prompted authorities to reimpose harsh lockdowns. And from the U.S., we get initial jobless claims figures. The number of Americans applying for unemployment benefits increased to 203,000 in the week ended May 7th, the highest reading since mid-February, but still below pre-pandemic averages. Up next, a look at the opening numbers at the Philippine Stock Exchange with Chris Mangan of Mangan on Markets. Market Edge will be right back. You're still watching Market Edge. The headlines: Wall Street suffers its worst day in 2 years as high inflation hits the earnings of major retailers. Asian shares also falling at the open. Here at home, the PSE index stretched its winning streak to a third day, essentially clawing back all of its losses from last week, all 6% of it. Can the momentum be sustained? We're back above 6,700 level. Chris Mangan of ManganOnMarkets.com joins us for his market outlook. Philippine Central Bank Governor Benjamin Jokno hints at policy tightening ahead of the BSP's meeting this afternoon, saying the space for easy monetary policy has narrowed due to high inflation. Will the liftoff happen today instead of the earlier telegraphed next month? And Tomas Lorenzo of Torre Lorenzo Development Corporation says there really is pent-up demand in the property market, adding by the end of 2021, the revenue is almost at pre-pandemic levels. Lorenzo also says occupancy in their university residences are picking up and construction of new projects did not stop despite the pandemic. He adds, going public is also an option on the table. The Philippine Stock Exchange opening lower this morning. We're about 2 minutes into trade, and so far the index is down 1.6%, 107 points, 66.20. And joining us today for his take on the markets, Chris Mangan, senior analyst at ManganOnMarkets.com. Chris, hi, good morning. Welcome back.
Good morning. Thanks for having me back, Mimi.
And congratulations on the very happy news for tying the knot.
Thank you very much.
Okay, let's start with the big picture. The PSE index has essentially clawed back the near 6% it lost last week. What's happening here? I mean, what's the market trying to tell us? Down 6% 1 week, up 6% the next 3 days. What's going on?
Yeah, well, the market is very erratic right now. But
it's not just here in the Philippines that we're seeing equities move like this. This is happening all over the world. And it's basically because of investors expecting a tighter monetary policy from central banks. Now, like you said earlier, our market is already up, has already recovered most of its losses from last week. I think we're seeing investors move from certain industries and cycle their investments. We are expecting a tightening of our own fiscal policy soon, but we'll see later on today.
Mm-hmm. We'll get to the BSP in a bit. I just wanted to know, so where do you see this index going? Clearly, it's very volatile, but do you think we've, you know, established new lows or new highs here, new resistance and support levels?
Well, I think in terms of the PSEI, I think it's going to hover around the 6,500 level in the coming weeks. Last week's losses were kind of irrational panic. We saw some irrational panic from some investors because of what's happening abroad. Some say it's because of the election, but I think there hasn't been much of an effect on the sentiment yet. So. We did see the market recover after last week's losses, but I think moving in the short term, I think we're going to see it consolidate around the 6,500 level.
All right, 6,500 level, and you've got the BSP meeting this afternoon. Do you think the market is ready for the Philippine Central Bank to join the growing chorus of rate hikes? I mean, the whole time we were made to believe that the rate hike is going to happen in June, and now it could happen today. Does it make any difference?
Well, I think most investors and analysts are already expecting a 25 basis point rate hike today. But personally, I think we're also going to see a reduction in the reserve ratio. And the reason why, which is an accommodative stance, by the way, so it kind of counters the effects of the rate hike. Now, the reason why I say that is because the central bank hasn't done anything for a while now, and by raising interest rates and at the same time cutting the cash reserve of banks, which injects liquidity into the economy, they can gauge what the actual status of our economy is. I mean, we're seeing very high inflation because of rising oil prices, and it looks like that the price of oil right now is here to stay. And then we had that strong GDP numbers come in for the first quarter because of the economy and restrictions staying very light, which allowed the economy to get back on its feet, and also because of election spending. The first quarter was right in the middle of the campaign season, and we saw a lot of economic activity. So basing their decision, there's going to be a lot of factors mm-hmm. for the central bank to change policy right now. And I expect a rate hike and a reserve ratio cut. Now, mm-hmm. what the effect on the market is going to be, I think it's already factored in. I think the market is going to sit here at current levels. There are other factors that concern companies listed on the PSE, and we can get to that later.
Mm-hmm. Just very quickly, Chris, when you've got rising interest rates, does that put pressure on listed companies to deliver more? Does that, you know, what does that do to the attractiveness of equities, of risk assets versus fixed income?
Well, historically, rising interest rates have meant lower stock prices because of the better, like you just said, the better dividend that they can get on fixed assets. But I don't think that's necessarily true anymore because of all the factors that involve and all the economic factors that are also at play. I don't think we're going to see that big of a drop in the valuation of equities, because if you look at first quarter earnings, you could see that a lot of companies have already picked up growth from before the pandemic. So it's not translating into stock prices at the moment, which potentially could mean a lot of growth for current prices. Mm-hmm. And that's why I don't think we're going to see prices drop. We're not going to see prices mm-hmm. drop. We're not going to see a substantial drop in the coming months.
All right. Very quickly, let's go over some interesting corporate stories. ING Bank Manila has named a veteran banker, Jun Palanca, as the head of its wholesale banking. We're also looking at state-run land bank, whose loans to the agri sector went up by 3% to 237 billion pesos in the first quarter of the year. Apparently, land bank is the biggest lender to the agri side. Chris, for investors and for traders, are you waiting on land bank to go public?
Yeah, well, they have said that they will come and list on the exchange. I think that's a very welcome development for the state-run bank. Mm-hmm. I think they're just getting their affairs in order, and they really have done a lot to land bank in the last few years. And that would be a welcome addition to the exchange.
Very interesting, because it recently merged with UCPB, right? And it's now among the top three big banks in the country. Here's another one from the property side. Century Properties Group posting a 22% profit growth in the first quarter at 249 million. That's as affordable housing and its leasing business segments performed well. Revenues also picking up by 26% to 2.6 billion. Are you bullish on the property side?
Oh, definitely, especially on the affordable housing sector. Mm. There's always going to be a demand for affordable housing, especially in a country like ours where we have a rapidly growing middle class. Mm. So if you look, their earnings there's several companies that are in this space that have already posted record earnings. So that's a sector that we're generally bullish on and will continue to be bullish on in the future.
Mm-hmm. From property to media, GMA Network says they're very optimistic they can beat last year's record profit. They're seeing an 8.2 billion pesos in earnings this year versus last year's 7.5, I think. Also, CapEx is pegged at 2 billion for this year. Are you bullish with media firms? I mean, it's an election year. It's supposed to be a great year.
Yeah, well, GMA has really done well since the removal of the franchise of its competitor. But they're kind of unchallenged right now at the moment in terms of how big they are, mm-hmm. and they're going to continue to grow revenues like that. So you can see their stock price dropped some last week, but it's recovered a lot in the first 3 days of this week. So I think investors are expecting a good dividend there, and I think we're going to see growth in that company as well.
More than its relationship with competitors, it's actually partnering with some of its competitors, the parent of this news channel. What about its relationship with the government, the press and the government? We have this statement from Mr. Gozon. He was saying, "We have no reason to believe that our relationship with the new government will not be friendly, harmonious, and proper." Do you see media companies as a regulatory play now or no?
Well, yeah, I think at the current price, I think there's more growth than fears of uncertainty. Mm. I don't think the government is going to be or is going to change its policies or its approach on this sector. I mean, they have been able to grow despite everything that's happened in the economy, and I think that's going to continue to be the case.
All right, we have this. BDO raises $100 million via a blue bond. So I think this is the first time that we're all hearing about a blue bond supposed to raise money for the ocean, right? For marine life projects, sustainable projects. Speaking of leadership change, PLDT is seeing a shakeup. Smart head of consumer business group Jane Basas has been appointed as the new president and CEO of MediaQuest Holdings. She's supposed to lead the integration of Signal, MediaQuest into this digital age. And she is replacing Ray Espinosa. In place of Jane Basas, they've actually poached Jollibee's marketing chief Francis Flores to head Smart's consumer business group. The telco space, do you think that all the good news have already been priced in when you look at the share prices of these telco giants?
Well, I think in terms of the stock price, I think the telco companies are trading at their fair value. Yeah, I think all the good news has been priced in. You're seeing new blood come in that are supposed to usher the digital age for and the future for these telco companies. You're seeing these young new blood come in, and that's going to be bullish for them moving forward. You see PLDT and Globe. Well, Globe is still trading somewhat at a discount to its 2022 high, but PLDT is up there and it's back almost at a multi-year high. So the remaining telco players is a different story. Now we're seeing that at their lows, because nobody knows what's going to happen to his empire. But I think
that's Dito, telecommunity of Dennis Oy, right?
That's correct. But I think Philippine telco sector is incredibly strong in terms of the business model, and in terms of the stock price, there's some uncertainty right now, but moving forward, I think this is a good bet.
All right. We have this just in. BPI also launching 100 billion pesos worth of bond and commercial papers program, and House Talk, which listed just this year in January, they say they've acquired 12 hectare property in Binian, Laguna, after a 93% increase in annual net income. So positive news from House Talk there and BPI. Let's go over to an interesting foreign story now. Global companies are boosting supplies of baby formula in the U.S. as America grapples with a shortage. Nestle says it's flying additional shipments from Netherlands and Switzerland. Well, Enfamil maker Reckitt Benckiser says it's already ramped up production by 30% this year. Abbott, the biggest supplier of powdered milk like Similac, is in talks to restart production at its Michigan factory. You know, Chris, we've been hearing more and more about a global food shortage, and now we're seeing milk shortage, at least in the U.S. How real is this risk, food shortage, for the Philippines?
Well, I think it's definitely a risk for the Philippines. We import a lot of our basic food items. Because of the pandemic and what we're seeing in Europe right now with the war, I think governments, countries are going to start moving to self-sufficiency instead of relying on this global trade, at least for the most basic of our commodities.
Staples,
and I think the Philippines needs to get in on that as well. I think we should have more food security. It's going to be hard for our energy requirement because of all the oil that we import. But at least on the food side, I think there's a lot to be done. But I think there's a real potential for us to be somewhat sufficient in some basic food items. And I think this is something that the government can focus on and should focus on. In the coming years.
And this is a space investors should watch, because we have some listed names that are into food and food security. Chris, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us, just describe. We're going to leave it to our viewers to guess what this is. So what do you have for us today?
Yeah, well, this is a property company that's, I don't want to give out too much, but it's also in the affordable housing sector, which, like I said earlier, is going to be, we're very bullish on because of the massive demand and the growing middle class that we have. I think as the economy grows, there's going to be increased demand for it, and therefore, we're going to see that translate into its stock price, and we're going to see a higher value for that company.
How much upside are we seeing? We just flashed a three-year chart for the stock price of this company. What sort of upside can we expect, say, in the next 6 to 12 months?
Yeah, well, we did see some sort of a drop in the last week as well. It's down by almost 25%, but that puts it at around 50 to 60% from its 2019 highs. So I think, if the economy keeps going the way it's going, and the company, it's a well-managed company, And if it keeps going the way it is, I think we'll see 30 to 40% growth from the stock price.
All right, 30 to 40 sounds great. Thank you very much, Chris, for joining us. Always a pleasure speaking with you. Have a great day.
Thank you, Mimi.
All right.
You too.
Now, moving on to other news, U.S. investigators believe the crash of China Eastern flight last March 21st that killed all 132 passengers and crew was deliberately done by someone on board. The so-called black box flight data recorders had been sent to the U.S. for analysis. Citing people familiar with the probe, the Wall Street Journal reports the data had shown someone had input orders to send the Boeing jet into a nosedive. U.S. officials believe their conclusion is backed up by the fact that Chinese investigators have so far not indicated any problems with the aircraft or flight controls that could have caused the crash. U.S. and Boeing officials have declined to comment on that report. The China Eastern flight was traveling from Kunming to Guangzhou when it inexplicably plunged into a mountainside in China's deadliest crash in around 30 years. Time to zip through the top headlines from major business papers. From Business World, local business groups are calling on the outgoing 18th Congress to pass economic reform bills in its remaining session days. Among the measures they want passed, the last two packages of the comprehensive tax reform program of the Duterte administration, the property valuation and assessment reform, and the passive income and financial intermediary taxation. From Business Mirror, the Philippine Trade Department lauds President Duterte's Executive Order 169, which seeks to protect MSMEs and the franchising industry. The EO aims to develop a transparent and business-friendly environment and promote fair and equitable practices in the franchising industry. And from the Wall Street Journal, the Biden administration is invoking the Defense Production Act to increase production of baby formula and authorize flights to import supply. The move aims to ease a nationwide shortage on baby formula caused by the closure of Abbott Nutrition's key plant in Michigan due to bacterial contamination. The 12 winning senatorial bets from the May 9 elections have now been proclaimed. Each of them had their moment on the PICC stage on Wednesday afternoon to receive their certifications and have their hands raised by the poll commissioners. Topping the senatorial race was actor and political rookie Robin Padilla, followed by returning Senator Loren Legarda and TV personality Rafi Tulfo.
Ang akin pong pagkapanalo ay isa pong simbolo ng pagkakaisa ng mga Muslim at Kristiyano. Halos umabot po ang 30 taon. Wala pong Muslim na naging senador.
Rounding out the so-called Magic 12 were re-electionist Sherwin Gatchalian, Francis Cheese Escudero, Mark Villar, Alan Peter Cayetano, Miguel Zubiri, Joel Villanueva, J.V. Ejercito, lone opposition Senator Risa Ontiveros, and Jingoy Estrada.
Patasahan po ninyo sa loob ng 6 na taon ang aking mga ipinangako sa taong bayan noong panahon ng kampanya, lalong-lalo na po ang pagbibigay ng trabaho sa ating mga Pilipino na walang trabaho ay maisa sa kotoparan.
A strong, independent Senate that will help Malacanang when it needs help, but will also correct and fiscalize when they have to be told that something is wrong is what our country needs now.
Chinese President Xi Jinping holds a phone conversation Wednesday with leading presidential bet Bongbong Marcos. China's ambassador to the Philippines says President Xi once again congratulated Marcos on his electoral victory. The Chinese leader supposedly described Marcos as a builder, supporter, and promoter of the friendship between China and the Philippines. The two also talked about bilateral ties and regional development. President Rodrigo Duterte thanks Filipinos who stayed loyal to him during his presidency. Duterte is preparing to step down from office on June 30. He spoke in Pasay City on Wednesday during a convention of retail giant Pure Gold. Speaking at the event, Duterte also stressed the importance of small and medium-sized enterprises to the Philippine economy.
I am on my tail end sa presidency ko. Pero yung tumulong sa akin, nagsuporta all these years, at yung umintindi ng mga hangarin ko sa ating bayan, I would like to express my gratitude sa inyo. This administration has always recognized small and medium-sized enterprises as one of the backbones of our economy. With the countless jobs that SMEs produce for the country's growing labor force, the aid in our aim to utilize our people's talent and in our fight to reduce hunger and poverty.
Switching gears now, a new media channel in the Philippines is set to give a digital upgrade to the traditional viewing experience. Jackie Pascual gives us a look at the Pinoy Interactive Entertainment, or PAI, channel.
Yan naman po kayo at i-manifest ang swerte dito sa
D.O.B.
Digital entertainment is coming soon in the Philippines with the launch of the Pinoy Interactive Entertainment, or PAI, channel. It's a mix of traditional and digital media, signaling the rise of a different viewing habit for Filipinos that is anchored on mobility and on being interactive.
Ano ba yung PAI?
PAI is a partnership of Globe's Chroma Entertainment, 917 Ventures, Beam TV, and ABS-CBN.
You're going to see more innovations that will make entertainment more immersive, engaging, and rewarding. Just as technology evolves, so does the behavior of our audience.
The new channel will feature interactive game shows, concerts, variety programs, and even an interactive teleserye where viewers can choose the plot of the series. PAI will also feature Kapamilya stars and social media influencers, attracting the youth market as well as the young at heart.
They will all be highly interactive and rewarding at the same time. Viewers will not just get to enjoy the entertainment, but can also take home prizes, cash man yan, experiences, or connections.
Hindi ka lang basta manunood. Pwede ka rin makisali at makasama through your TV and mobile devices.
PAI will officially be launched on May 23 from 5 a.m. to 2 a.m. It will be available online on digital TV and Sky Cable Channel 21. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
And before we go, for those who try to guess the blind item, this is the pick of Chris Mangan. This is a company that is already whose share price is already 50 to 60% below its 2019 high. He's actually seeing a 30 to 40% upside. In the short term, this stock is Affordable Housing Developer 8990 Holdings, or House. Do let us know if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. In the meantime, that is it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. Keep it here on ANC.